So our next talk is by Rudy and Cenk about how Sipgate uses Debian and other open source software.
Test, test. Ah. Hello and good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us here. My name is Rudolf Bott. I've been working for a company named Sipgate, a German company, for 7 years now. And I'm mostly involved with our infrastructure. Right now, I'm mostly involved with client infrastructure, but I used to be involved with all kinds of servers, network stuff, and my colleague Cenk.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. Thanks for having us. I'm Cenk, and working since February at Sipgate, and I'm in the team which manages systems and network stuff.
Does anyone of you know Sipgate already, maybe? Okay. Just a quick overview. We're a company based in Düsseldorf with in a nice courtyard, so it's kind of hard to find, but it looks looks nice. We are a telecommunications company. I just shamelessly stole our website here. I'm sorry, it's German. We do the thing we started with is voice over IP telephony for private customers. We then added later Sipgate Team, which is our business product. It's a virtual PBX hosted by us. We also added later mobile. We are a mobile virtual network operator, so we are able to offer SIM cards, at least in Germany. And we also offer trunking services for your own PBX, and we offer various APIs to do real-time call manipulations, and we offer both inbound and outbound APIs for all kinds of fun stuff you can do with phone calls. We also have, we call it Horizon 2 products, which are new products. One is the satellite app. Some might have heard of it. It's basically an app that allows you to have a mobile phone number, a German phone mobile phone number, in an app, so it's voice over IP. So you can actually disconnect your phone number from your SIM card. So you can actually change your provider, use a data-only SIM card or wireless network to use your mobile phone number in Germany or wherever else. And this has been out for iPhone for about a year, and we just released the Android app 2 weeks ago. And also, Klink is also a new type of product. It's basically a new way of business telephony. It's like the Slack for telephony thing. You can check out any of those products and ask us questions later on if you like. We also have business in England or in the UK, which is basically the same except the mobile stuff, because we're not a network operator in the UK. And that's about it with the marketing stuff for today. We have some technical facts for you. We run about 700 servers, 250 out of those are bare metal servers, which is mostly telephony related because virtualization is still not good if you do any kind of real-time phone call stuff, at least if you want a decent quality. We run databases on hardware, of course, virtualization nodes and other infrastructure stuff, and it's all Debian-based. Except those few office services, which still require Microsoft stuff. But it's like it's only a handful. Our client systems are, well, mostly Lenovo with Debian or Ubuntu. That's up to the person running the notebook to decide. Or Apple has been crawling up from behind and taking over many of our systems. And we do have some Windows test environments, which we mostly run on AWS workspaces, which works quite nicely and is less a hassle than providing VMs by ourselves for our colleagues. And speaking of colleagues, we're about 180 employees, and we're all based in Düsseldorf, so there's no home office, no abroad office. We also do the UK business from Germany. And you may also know us from rather not so famous incidents, as being not able to handle ticket systems very well. We fixed that. I think this happened twice, and this is the second time. But also, we might know us from various other events like sponsoring DevConf 15 or 17 and last year's Mini DevConf here and this year's DevConf or Mini DevConf, and we also are involved in some other open source projects like Camaleo, which is an open source SIP router, and does also other stuff, but that's not my personal domain, so I'm not very involved with that. However, we do use lots of open source software. We just try to name a few, which you will find in our infrastructure. And today we'd like to give you a short introduction to some of them, and by some I mean kind of like those. Hope you can read that. Yeah. And but you can also use today and tomorrow to ask us anything about the others if you know something from that slide. So first of all, I'm going to do a short introduction to how we use Debian packaging, which we use a lot internally. So this will be a less fancy version of what you just saw earlier. Then how we do unattended upgrades, how we kind of had to build our own certificate authority, internal certificate authority, and why we did we have to do that, and how we use Genity as our virtualization platform, which is present in Debian as well, I know, and how we use the Elk stack. So we might run out of time at some point, and if that happens, we will skip the Elk stack, and if there's any interest in that, we will provide this as a lightning talk tomorrow. But we'll see how far we get. So first of all, how we deploy applications at Zipgate. Applications means our own software stack, which is quite a lot of software, mostly based on Java and some Perl, which we not talk about, and that's the main part, I think. So we have an internal GitHub Enterprise instance running at on-premise. This pushes a Jenkins instance. Since the setup is now almost 4 years old, this is all based on Jenkins 1, so it's not Jenkins 2. And we also use a software called, Jenkins Debian Glue. Does anyone know that? It's been written by Mika Prokop, so you might know him as a fellow Debian enthusiast. And this kind of mostly handles all of our needs related to packaging, Debian packaging. So it actually bundles, I think, CowBuilder and PBuilder and DPKG build package and lots of other things. And you basically just throw one command in your Jenkins shell blob, and this does the rest. So we use change routes for building, or CowBuilder-based change routes. So you can build for all kinds of different Debian versions at the same time in pristine new environments. They will be reset up on each run. We then sign and upload packages, and this is the Aptly logo. So we use Aptly as our repository software. Well, then we use Ansible to deploy our software. So these are all stacked Jenkins jobs. They just call each other and push information in between those. For example, in the very first step, during the clone and build step, there will be a version number will be generated, and this will be passed along all the jobs, and the Ansible playbook in the final step will install this very package and not something else, or the latest one, or whatever. This is like a typical pipeline view, this is the view from it's the build pipeline plugin from Jenkins 1. If you use Jenkins 2, it has something like that built in. So you can re-execute every step of those. This is a pipeline that has been completely run, and you can see the clone step, the build step, the upload step, followed by the deploy step, which is an Ansible playbook being run with the environment pointing to our dev servers and doing its thing, whatever the playbook does or what it's supposed to do. It does call some tests, and if that works, it would be able to be deployed to the live system, but that is always a manual step. So you always need to click on the play button here, because we don't do we do continuous integration, but not in continuous delivery. Someone has to check what happened and click on the button. We never got around to change that in the past 4 years, but it works quite well for us. Before we had that, all of our developers had to package their software themselves and had to deploy the software themselves, had to know which server to connect to and whatever else is associated with that. And that actually reduced our time to be able to ship new software to a live system from like the probation period of 6 months to probably like the second week of your experience at ZipGate, and of course made things a lot more consistent than before. The only problem is what do you think? How many Jenkins jobs do we have? As I said, it's multiple. Well, see, if you've been able to see, we have multiple jobs per packets, so it's a lot. So it's at some point we removed our staging system, because after automating everything, there was no difference between the dev and the staging system. So we just skipped one, and that kind of got rid of a lot of tasks. But you don't want to have to manage this amount of Jenkins jobs on your own or by hand. So we actually are using Jenkins Job Builder, which is a project. I think it's somewhere based in the OpenStack area, and it's basically a set of YAML files which describe just how a job needs to look like. It defines a macro, and then you can just have a second YAML file with a long list of things. And we do solve lots of things by naming conventions. So the repository is connected to the package name and to the playbook name, and so there's less configuring and more convention going on there. And this has made things very, very easy for us in the past years. And of course, if you need to change something, how your jobs behave, you only need to change the job template, and all your jobs will be changed in Jenkins. So, and actually, the Jenkins job configuration job is also a Jenkins job. So, whenever you change something in the repository with the Jenkins configuration, it will update itself or destroy itself, whatever you did. Well, we haven't had that in the last 4 years. So, okay. Is it dead? Okay. Okay. So this slide was supposed to tell you that we were using RepRepo as a repository software earlier, if you want to do continuous delivery, or you also need to implement rollback. So if you deliver a package that is broken, either because your test didn't cover whatever is broken, but if the broken package somehow ends up in the dev or live system, you want to have a rollback to the last working version. So we needed to have multiple versions of packages in our repository, which is something RepRepo doesn't support. So at that point, we switched to Aptly, because Aptly allows for multiple versions of the same package. And this all works by Jenkins remembering the version it built and the version that was installed before on the destination system. So it, for example, only installs the version that you just built, and if that fails, it rolls back to the last version to have all your systems in a consistent state, and not just, for example, one backend of your 5 backends is just down because it failed, and then it just stopped and nobody noticed until monitoring tells someone else who's not involved with the deployment. So that's why we changed to Aptly. And there were some numbers on here, and I think it said something like we have roughly 400 or 300 something packages for Debian Jesse and 200 packages for Debian Stretch. And well, unique packages, and if you take into account the older versions, it's like 1,500 packages and 1,200 for both of those distributions. So as you can see, we use Debian packaging quite heavily, which does not mean that everyone knows how to package. Actually, nobody knows how to package at Zipgate. This is a constant stream of annoyance, at least from a point of view from our developers. They usually forget how that works and just copy things from existing jobs. And well, if you start with a nice and clean Debian folder for a new project, at some point you will change things and do something probably nasty that works for this kind of job. And if you copy this one to the next one, you will end up with a lot of confusion. And at some point someone tells you that your job builds way too long, and then you figure out that he actually builds in the clean step and then in the build step again and just copied things and didn't know what he did. So this is, well, we use Debian packages, but they sometimes cause friction. But for us, at least it works well, and it ensures a consistent state on the target system. So let's see if the next slide is also broken. Yes, apparently it is. Oh, I found that slide. Okay. So, yeah, these are roughly the numbers that I told you. And we also have third-party software in our repository, which is for various reasons, because, for example, it's not available in Debian, or it's, well, it's probably too old, and Backpots is also too old, or whatever. And sometimes we just require extra patches or build flags, and we need to rebuild those packages and have them in our repository. But we try to not do that, which because it also means we need to take care of security patches and keep track of what happens upstream. And usually we try to leave that job with Debian because they do a better job at that end than us. And this is, oh wow, this works great. Okay. So actually, this slide was supposed to show you the activity in our deployment Git repository, which contains all of our Ansible stuff. So it's roughly, in 4 years, there have been roughly 13,000 commits by 70 people. So we have 285 playbooks using 275 roles. And most of them are actively used. We have 25 custom modules, which either means we have written them ourselves or we were a bit ahead of time in our Ansible installation, or actually the Ansible installation was too old, so we just imported a module from a newer version. And right now, our minimum Ansible version is 2.7, which means we're kind of almost up to date. Those playbooks are used for deployment by Jenkins, but also for manual deployment to set up local development environments on workstations or in Vagrant boxes or whatever. They're used to do maintenance sometimes and also to set up servers in general. We also used Puppet a while ago, but we stopped doing that in favor of Ansible because, well, Ansibles were already in place for deployments, so why not use it for setup as well? It works quite well for us. And actually, at some point, we noticed that if you have all your configuration in Ansible, who needs server backups anymore, unless you have data on your servers? And we just, I think it's probably we reduced our backups, backup needs by half, because we just, it doesn't make sense to backup a server which has nothing on it than stuff that comes out of Ansible, so it's defined somewhere else. That's about it for the packaging part, and now Cenk will tell you a bit about how we do unattended upgrades and not spam your mailing lists anymore.
Yeah, we are doing unattended upgrades kind of on scale, and we're doing it because you want obviously stay up to date and be safe against security threats, and to get the performance improvements of new versions of software. And also, it's better to change incrementally than have smaller changes than have update from 1.0 to 1.9 or even to a new major version. Yeah, we also want to eliminate toil, means that we do not want to do manual tasks, repetitive tasks manually, and yeah, this mostly is boring and can lead to mistakes. And yeah, before this, our automated annotated upgrades, we used a mechanism that checked against the security mailing list or and an ISS feed and checked the packages against our environment and looked for if we are using this, and if yes, notified us to manually upgrade this package. And yeah, now mostly we're doing attend upgrades on all of our systems. And yeah, we're doing this with cron jobs. We have configured a cron job on the systems, which has configured to run either on day or at night. We prefer doing this not at night, because if an incident pops up, we want to respond as fast as possible, and that's mostly possible on day. And yeah, our services are mostly deployed to a minimum of two servers to be redundant, and we then just do unattended upgrades always on one host of a host group, so that not both machines will reboot at the end or fail. Yeah, and our mechanism is a wrapper around unattended upgrade itself, the Debian package. Yeah, and we're doing this with the cron job starts and checks if there are updates available for the system. If yes, it starts with doing pre-upgrade tasks. And the pre-upgrade task is first checks if there is a lock for this host group, if it's possible to update, and locks are set mostly when another upgrade is in progress on the other pair of the service, or we are currently deploying to this system. So we are not rebooting or doing unattended upgrades on systems which are currently have deployment ongoing. If the previous task exits well, we set a lock for the system, and yeah, sets obviously a downtime in the monitoring for the services and the system itself, and start doing service-specific maintenance tasks. These are mostly tasks like deregister from the load balancer and do not accept new requests on the system, or like do not accept new phone calls on the system and wait the current phone calls to finish, and yeah, continue with the reboot. Yeah, after the packages get upgraded, we get a notification on Slack which tells us which packages will be have been upgraded, and after this notification the system starts to reboot. And after reboot, we're doing post reboot tasks like service specific maintenance tasks, like for example register back at the load balancer or start accepting new phone calls, and as well as removing the lock or setting the downtime off. And yeah, we're doing this since we started with unattended upgrades on every system on October, and till this year, May, we had around 4,060-70 reboots, and this means we had around 20 reboots per day. We have also the possibility to stop unattended upgrades. We built a global kill switch mechanism to not allow reboots or not allow unattended upgrades. But I think we never used this, but maybe we will need it sometime. Yeah, and why we are, why we have this pre-tasks and post-tasks, and why we don't just reboot or restart. Yeah, it's because we when we started with this, we don't have this fancy microservice architecture to just remove the service and everything works fine. We have many legacy software which doesn't allow us to just restart it. And we are not every time a reboot is needed, and if a reboot is needed, perfectly package would tell us if we need to reboot, but we experience that not every package is telling us if a reboot is required. So to be safe, we just reboot. And also libraries which get updated do not notify the services which are using these libraries to restart. Yeah, and we are doing all of this without any impact to our users. Nothing breaks, and it just works actually.
Just one addition. When we had to figure out how to reboot all of our services, we just the team said, well, we need to figure out how to reboot which service and what to do before you can reboot a service, and what pre-tasks to execute actually for this very service, because the operations team doesn't know each and any service, of course. So they actually wrote lots of sticky notes and put one service per sticky note and just put them outside on their office on the wall, and just we have an internal communication system named Yammer, which is something like an internal Facebook thing. I don't recommend it, but it works. Rather, whatever. So they just said, well, whenever you walk past our office or get a coffee, because the coffee machine is around the corner, just look at the wall and all the sticky notes. And if you find a system you know, just put it into three lanes, which they also prepared. And it says, reboot or reboot with tasks, don't reboot at all, or something else was there also, I think. And within a day, they had like, I think they had answers to 60 or 70 systems without doing any meetings or consulting lots of people or Fachabteilung, as probably other people would say. We don't have that, but that was fairly easy, and that allowed them to just start with lots of systems, because they would have never known how to find out who to ask, or is it safe to reboot, or will things break, or will they break later, or whatever. So that was actually a quite good experience. So how to run your own certificate authority? What do we need certificates for? Well, for example, internal or development websites and services, just plain HTTPS. We use Bakula for backup, which relies on working CA. We use TLS syslog. I hope everybody else does as well. We use databases, MySQL, which is rather pain with if you want to do anything with certificates or SSL, but we'll still try to use that. And you name it, whatever else uses certificates. So you probably have heard of Let's Encrypt at some point in the last years. So why not use just that, because it's that's exactly what we need. Well, the problem is it has those challenges or validation challenges, like the HTTP, where it connects to an open port on your system, or DNS, where you have to put something in DNS to validate the host name. And unfortunately, all of those don't work for us, because we don't want to open random ports on all of our servers to their validation system. And DNS is one of the last systems which we haven't automated that well, read at all, and so this wasn't a good option. But still, again, Let's Encrypt is open source. There, I think it's called ACME server, whatever it's called. It is open source. Well, why not just use that? And if you browse their forums, you will see lots of people asking, "Hey, can I use your system because it's open source and I need just that?" And whatever. On all those questions, you find the same answer. Yes, it's open source, but it's not ready for home use. There's no real documentation. They have a Docker container, which is only for development. And from that, you can kind of guesstimate how it works, but at some point they just we try to evaluate it, and from well, we started on day one, and on day three they just added an entire RabbitMQ system somewhere in the middle of that, and didn't tell in their readme. So we just didn't know why everything broke. We tried, and at the end, actually, the ECMI server is just a wrapper around a CFSSL, which I explained on the next slide. And it just adds the whole part about registration, email accounts, validation, and notification, which is not what we need for an internal CA, because why? So we looked at that CFSSL thing, which is Cloudflare SSL, and it's just a very small set of SSL-related tools, and also a simple CA, which offers an HTTP API or REST API. And well, let's just see what we require from a CA, or what we assumed about a CA. For example, we want a root CA which lives somewhere offline and runs for a very long time, probably 100 years or 50 or whatever. And it's usually hidden on multiple medias in various safes somewhere, but it's offline. So we have intermediate CAs, which are used for the actual signing, which are valid for example, 1 year. It's probably a good start. And the certificates themselves are only valid for example, 3 months, or until the intermediate CA expires, of course, whatever happens first. And the CA only issues certificates for a known set of domains. So we don't want to run a CA that just issues random certificates. And if someone knows how to use that, he can just issue certificates for whatever, google.de or something. That is probably not the best idea. We just said the requirement is certificates must be renewed automatically, along with a service restart or reload or whatever the service using the certificate is required to do. A spoiler alert, MySQL is not very good with that. We want the root CA on all of our relevant systems deployed, and all systems need to serve the current intermediate CA to not have that also to be deployed to all systems. In our case, this is how the whole thing works. We have clients, which are just servers in our case. We use traffic and console for the load balancing part, but this is not essential to this setup. We just do that because we already had that in our infrastructure. You can use whatever you like for load balancing. So we have multiple backends running the CFSSL API, which is just a simple process. And it can either use an intermediate CA stored on disk, or you can also use like hardware crypto modules. Depends on your needs or tasks. And we have a shared Postgres database, which just syncs the state of the CFSSL CA. So how does my service receive a certificate and auto-renewal? So to do that, we actually, as I already said, we use Ansible for everything. We just provided an Ansible task that it can be included by anyone requiring a certificate. And this does all the magic. So it will create, it will just install the required set of scripts that runs on your server and does regular checks if things need to be renewed. You also provide the command to actually reload this service. So sometimes it's probably like a service Apache 2 restart, and it can sometimes it's also something more sophisticated. It just depends on your service. The only thing we had to learn that the more services you have using SSL, the more crappy it gets with the format they expect those certificates. Sometimes you used to. Has anyone been using Stunnel at some point? That for some reason they require the DH params to be included in the file. I don't know, but some need the keys and certificates separated. Other need them in a certain order, and this list just got longer and longer the further we digged into our infrastructure. How does the renewal work? Well, the cron job runs each day between 11 and 12 a.m. Again, we try to do most things during work hours to have more people available if something breaks. And this cron job is spread between 11 and 12 across all systems. A certificate will be replaced 10 days ahead of expiry. Remember, we have three months of certificate validness. And 10 days ahead of expiry was just a guesstimate to think, okay, well, if the CA is broken for some reason, we have 10 days to fix that until whatever CIPgate mails down. So, well, after retrieving the certificate, the service reload command will be triggered, and that's about it. So simple as that. Security aspects. First of all, as I already said, we only want to issue certificates for whitelisted domains, not any domain, because since the CA is present on all of our systems, if someone gets a hold of our CA and is able to request random certificates, all of our clients would trust that, which is probably not what we want. So, short-lived certificates are better than long-lived ones from security view. If someone is able to get a certificate, it will at least not last that long. And we also already think about lowering because it works so well. We thought about maybe probably a month is also okay instead of three. We do authentication only on a network level, because it's simple and good enough for our use case. We thought about doing advanced authentication, whatever stuff. But if you, for example, let's say you use basic authentication in front of your API, you end up storing those credentials on each server. And what's the difference? If someone takes a hold of your server, which he needs to talk to the CA, he will also probably find the credentials. And that you don't gain anything from that. And if you do something more sophisticated, it will get more complicated and it will probably break at some point. So we decided to do the first take with just that. That's what I just said. And this is a look at the database. So within the, I think the time frame is actually a year now. That's the point our old CA expired. And we have issued 15,000 certificates since then, but also one of my colleagues told me that probably 2,000 of those are just test runs by him, but it just works and it never broke so far. The only thing that is still resisting is MySQL. We need to restart our databases manually because you probably don't want to restart a production database at 11 during the day, during daytime, not at night as well, at least not without supervision. And we still need to work on that, but as far as I know, I think MariaDB has implemented hot reloading of certificates. So that's probably a way to work around that in the future. And next topic, back to Cenk.
Yeah, how are we playing the virtualization game? We're using Ganetti. Ganetti is our virtualization platform, which is developed by Google, and Google used a long time, and I think it's partly uses it still. Yeah, as I said, it's our cluster management for VMs based on Xen, KVM, or LXC. Ganeti is a shared nothing cluster with job management, which means that we have one master node which receives all jobs to be executed, like creating or deleting a VM or starting or stopping. And the master node can be swap between a pre-configured number of other nodes. So we, in case of the master failure, we can switch to another node being the master, and we have no single point of failure here. Ganetti is mostly CLI focused and provides some nice command line commands and nice REST API, and we built with this nice REST API a web front end for us. which you can use. It's open source. Yeah. We have three Ganeti clusters located on three different locations, which consist about 31 nodes, on which we have around 400 instances with many CPU cores and around 3 terabytes of memory. And our when you use the DRBD backend for your server for your instances, you can. Also, the VMs are the redundant because in case of a node failure, the VM will start on the on another hardware node with minimal disruption or no disruption if you migrate them instead of stopping and starting them on the new one. And Ganeti offers the possibility to set node groups. This means that you can have some subclusters in your cluster, and we are using this method to bundle different hardware generations together so that the service runs for example only on the new hardware or only on the new hardware. We are using for replication and migration another network interface or network instead of for the other ones. Ganeti provides a nice tool called HBall. This is a cluster balancer, and it looks into to the current state of the cluster with total free memory, disk memory, and memory, and then places the instances in a better distributes the instances in a better way that we have that we all know better. The current state of Ganeti is mostly stopped. Google stopped active developing on the project. Some months ago, the last version was released not by Google, but this is a big issue for the project, as well as we have problems, for example, with live migrations with Java applications, which just end up in a broken state if we migrate them live to a new node. And in 2 weeks, short break, in 2 weeks is the GanetiCon in Umeå in Sweden, and maybe there will, we will have a current state of the future resulted of this GanetiCon, I hope.
Some of you might know Apollon, probably, who is the current Debian maintainer of Ganeti. And he's actually the guy who we quoted, and he was the one who released the 2.16 version recently. And he already has access to the repository, but we're still waiting for an answer from Google on how they will proceed and if they will release the repository to the public or at least to the community. This is unfortunately has not been settled so far. In December, they said any moment now, so we see how that turns out.
Rudy said in the beginning that we maybe have not enough time, but we have a little presentation about the LSEC. If anyone wants to see that, come to us. We can present it tomorrow at Lightning Talks as a Lightning Talk. Yeah. Let's look at this.
No
spoiler.
Yeah.
There was a shortcut to the Q&A.
Ah.
But thanks so far.
Can we take one or two questions? Is that fine with the video team? Okay, so if there are some questions, please line up at the microphone. I just want to comment that Postgres does hot reloading of certificates these days. Not sure about MirayDB.
Well, we're not good with Postgres, unfortunately.
So you said you have 20 reboots a day. Is that per server or for all the servers? And why do you reboot so often? I mean, I reboot when I install a new kernel.
And yeah. As I said, there are packages which requires a reboot, like the kernel, when the kernel package is installed, updated. But we experience that like when we update the Intel microcode package, that it does not touch the var reboot required file. And we want to be safe with this and just reboot every time when a package updates.
We thought it would be easier to just reboot any time instead of trying to figure out which libraries need service restarts and just do it any time.
But you don't reboot one machine 20 times a day?
No. It's 20 machines per day.
Okay. So, and how often is each machine rebooted then? Once a week or?
Every time, mostly once a week or sometimes more.
Depends on how well the Debian security team works. And but usually there's something to update every week, and the systems just check on their regular schedule, and if there's something, they install it and reboot.
Just a short question. You said you won't reboot a machine which has an ongoing call. What do you do if somebody is talking on the phone for like a week?
But we do have a maximum.
That's interesting.
It's a very long period, but actually in this case I think it just fails and notices us that we couldn't reboot the system. It just re-adds into the phone routing again.
Okay. Because we have issues with our phone provider where the call is automatically stopped like after 2 hours or 3 hours.
That's short.
Which is interesting if you have telephone conference and after 3 hours it goes like doot and you're disconnected. And I was wondering if this is something like that. Oh, we have a security update and we have to reboot now. Well, we're not using Zipgate.
The phone systems are one of the few systems that don't reboot during daytime because it takes forever to drain them during daytime, but it works better at night.
Yeah.
And or early night. And actually, last year I had to do some manual work on the system, and I drained it during the day. And after 3 hours, there was only one phone call left on this system, and the destination number was the Deutsche Telekom hotline. And I I felt sorry for this person, and we just skipped the maintenance. I thought that would probably not be so nice.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Well, if you have any more questions, just feel free to ask us during the days.
Maybe a question. So for your own services, is that Ansible telling the service to update, or how does it figure out it needs, if you have several microservices doing it, this is just because of the lock, then only one gets updated, or how is that working? Do you have some, canary stuff to update this? Or how is this workflow between Jenkins and unattended upgrade? Is there any workflow between it, or is this totally separate?
It's separated. We use Jenkins to deploy packages, and for infrastructure stuff, we just running Ansible on our machines.
Okay, so that is just instantaneous out of Jenkins update.
After implementing the unattended upgrade process, we took a deep dive into the Jenkins job builder and just edited all those jobs at once to check the log. So if Jenkins is starting to do deployment and it will figure out beforehand that there's an ongoing upgrade and will not deploy, and the other way around the same, this is what Jenkins described, if the unattended upgrade starts and sees there's a log for this system from Jenkins' side, it will not do the unattended upgrade to not break the deployment. But it will always notice the Slack channel that something didn't work for that reason or the other reason.
Okay. Well, there's one comment from IC about the neat restart package or file about the reboot thing. I'm just mentioning it here. Okay, so I think we're running a bit out of time. Let's thank the speakers again.